Oh, good morning and welcome to everybody, and welcome to everybody online as well. It's good to see you out on this fine, sunny bank holiday weekend. And let us start our service in prayer. Let us pray. Wonderful God, you are our Creator, Saviour and Sustainer. As we come out of the darkness and into your light, let us worship you, the God of infinite mystery, yet the God who is closer to us than our own breath. Wonderful God, as we gaze at the miracle of your world, intricate and interconnected, huge in scope, microscopic in detail, we are amazed. We wonder that you love each one of us, seeing us, knowing us, and filling us with the breath of life. You hold us in being moment by moment, from the time we exit the womb until the time we return to you. Help us to worship you with all our heart, to greet you as our friend, and with you to care for the whole of creation. Amen. And let us continue our prayer with some contemplative music.
When my hope is lost and my strength is gone, I run to you and you alone. When I can't get up and I can't go on, I run to you and you alone. 'Cause you're my light in the dark, and I sing with all of my heart. Thank you.
Right, so hallelujah to that. So we have an open mic for anybody who wants to share anything through the week, or if anybody online has left a message on Facebook. So I was going to use it. I'll have to go over there now. Right, thank you, Minister. Just like to say thanks everybody for the prayers they've given for my brother Alan, my younger brother, who, for those who don't know, got sick Friday last weekend and was rushed into hospital and was diagnosed with cancer. He's had an operation sort of during the week, and hopefully that's all gone well, and he's now in recovery from the operation, but it may well be quite a long process, as it were, before he's fully recovered. But he's in a good place at the moment and desperate to get some sleep, and he's wanting a good meal as well and a pint of Guinness, I think, at some point. So hopefully we'll get to that stage soon. But thanks everybody for all your prayers and support during the week. It's been much appreciated. Anybody else? Is that hand? People waving at me. Alrighty, in which case we'll continue in prayer. Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we praise you for the might and the mystery of your being, for seeing your light in the midst of our darkness. We praise you for the uniqueness and the unity of your fellowship. We praise you for drawing us together and for setting us apart. We praise you in song, in silence, in the mundane, and in the special. We praise you, God of truth. We bring to you our sorrow for our sins. Forgive us and strengthen us, we pray, for we are truly sorry. Living God of light, you choose to save, not to judge. To forgive, not to condemn. To turn towards, not away. To show us your nature and not to hide. To allow us to know you, to love you, and to serve you. And for all these things and more, we are truly thankful. Amen. Now Emma's going to bring us our reading.
Good morning. Our reading is taken from John chapter 3, verses 1 to 17. Jesus teaches Nicodemus. Now, there was a Pharisee, a man named Nicodemus, who was a member of the Jewish ruling council. He came to Jesus at night, and he said, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one could perform the signs you are doing if God were not with him." Jesus replied, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again. How can someone be born again when they are old?" Nicodemus asked, "Surely they cannot enter a second time into their mother's womb to be born." Jesus answered, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they are born of water and the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying, 'You must be born again.' The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it is going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit." "How can this be?" Nicodemus asked. "You are Israel's teacher," Jesus said, "and do you not understand these things? Very truly, I tell you, we speak of what we know, and we testify to what we have seen, but still you people do not accept our testimony. I have spoken to you of earthly things, and you do not believe. How then will you believe if I speak of heavenly things? No one has ever gone into heaven except the one who came from heaven, the Son of Man. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes may have eternal life in him. For so God loved the world, that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Thanks be to God for this reading.
And now Emma doesn't get a chance to sit down. We've now got our hymn, hymn 366, and I think we've got a few people who are going to sing from the front for us. It's got a few people, startled people in front of it. So we're going to have hymn 366, and Can It Be That I Should Gain? Did you want to sing the electric?
And can it be that I should gain?
Who here is scared of the dark? A few hands going in. Who likes going out at night when things you could see in the light are masked from sight? When the mind plays tricks on you and convinces you things are there which could not possibly be there? The darkness conceals a lot of what we can normally see. However, it also masks a lot of what we want to hide. We can use darkness to conceal what we do not want others to see. From our reading today, Nicodemus, a local religious leader, visited Jesus at night. Why? Why did Nicodemus come to Jesus at night? It was a risky and dangerous thing to do. There are a number of suggestions as to why Nicodemus came under the cover of darkness. Was the night the only time that he had free in his schedule? Was he worried about what his peers might think? Was Nicodemus seeking time with Jesus because he anticipated that Jesus would be interrupted by the crowds? Was he so taken with Jesus that he could not wait until daylight? Or was he exercising caution or demonstrating cowardice? Or did he come to Jesus in the dark because Nicodemus himself was in the dark? Nicodemus was a man who was spiritually hungry. Even though he was a Pharisee, he realized he was in the dark about Jesus. Nicodemus was a religious and well-educated man, yet his religion was not satisfying. Nicodemus still felt a darkness in his life. God has made us all in such a way that we will not find rest until we find it in him and let him deep into our own hearts. Saint Augustine once said, "Yes, Nicodemus was religious, but he also had a part of him that was restless because spiritually he was hungry." Isn't that why he was taking risks and secretly talking with Jesus in the first place? Nicodemus has also been seen by scholars as a symbol of the Jewish nation as a whole. Nicodemus spoke to Jesus as if he were representing the curiosity of others as well as himself. Right before our scripture passage for this morning, Jesus had gone to the temple and exhibited some major religious and righteous indignation. He was so disgusted by the corruption in God's temple that he overturned the tables and drove the money changers out. And I think Nicodemus was in the temple the day when Jesus did this. I think Nicodemus knew that Jesus was right about the corruption. And Nicodemus knew Jesus was confident and assured and the man to stand up and do that in the temple. Perhaps Nicodemus had wanted to see that done for a long time himself, but never would he have the confidence. In any event, this gets Nicodemus, this honest, truth-seeking, God-loving religious leader, interested in the man of Jesus. So Nicodemus comes to Jesus at night. "Rabbi," he says, "we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, but no one could perform the signs you're doing if God were not with him." And to this, Jesus says something that really confuses this Pharisee, with a list of credentials as long as my arm. "How can someone be born when they are old? Nicodemus asks. Surely they cannot enter a second time into the mother's womb to be born. And so, Jesus starts explaining what he means. But Nicodemus still doesn't understand that Jesus is not talking about some kind of physical rebirth, but rather a spiritual birth. You are Israel's teacher, and you do not understand these things, Jesus asks. So, then Jesus moves to something Nicodemus should understand. He refers back to Hebrew scriptures, what we call the Old Testament, to something that happened in Numbers. The image that a bronze serpent Moses lifted over the people as a cure for snake bites. In that situation, the Israelites were crying out for deliverance from a plague of deadly serpents. And God tells Moses to make an image of a serpent and lift it up on a pole. The Israelites had to look at an image of the very thing that was tormenting them to be healed. Jesus uses that story to say that he will be lifted up, and if you look at his death, your problem of death will be solved. It's like a vaccine, isn't it? I received my second vaccine this week. The nurse injected me with a small amount of inert COVID-19 stimulant. Now my body is producing antibodies that will ward off the real version of COVID-19 should I be unfortunate enough to come into contact with it. So in the gospel, Jesus is raised up on the cross in death. And when we look at Jesus' death, we are injected with the vaccine of the gospel. But what that means is that the way a person is born again, as Jesus has been describing this to Nicodemus, is by being crucified with Christ. This then is Jesus' direct setup for the infamous John 3:16 verse. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. I mean, we all love the promise of eternal life, and we are all drawn to the promise that we will not perish. And we like the apparent simplicity that we all need to do to get these good things is to believe. And that is true. But the word belief can sometimes become so academic, so one-dimensional, that many of us might take it for granted and thus hardly notice it at all. But a belief that leads to eternal life is a risky, courageous trust in Jesus with our whole lives, our entire selves. Jesus wraps up his teaching with a discussion about light and darkness, saying that the main problem with people in this world is that we love the dark. People live in the dark because they don't want their deeds to be exposed in the light, Jesus says. They do not want to change their ways, even though their ways are miserable and are killing them. They're used to them and even come to love them in some strange and perverse way. But that's okay. Faith always starts in the darkness, just like Nicodemus's experience with Jesus did. For an example, let's look back at the story Jesus used about the snake on the pole. The Israelites, who were dying of snake bites in the wilderness, did not at first understand how a serpent on a pole could save them. What they did was they first realized that these snakes were going to kill them, and they didn't want that. They needed a savior. So they trusted that God would deliver them, and their experience of being healed led to their conviction, the effectiveness of God's surprising mode of deliverance, the lifting up of the serpent. In the same way, we do not have to understand the cross of Christ before we can be saved by it. All we need is a desire to leave the darkness for the light and then look to Jesus to be saved. What it means is trusting in Jesus and taking that leap of faith before we can see exactly where it is all going to lead. And as our lives are changed, as we find ourselves born again, transformed, changed from the inside out, that is when we become convinced that God's mode of deliverance is effective and true. Seen in this context, those famous words in John become startling, because the main thing we need to do, what we need to believe to be born again, is that Jesus' death saves us. We need to forget the idea that we can just help ourselves, put ourselves out of the darkness, earn our own salvation, or in any way get by on our own. Nicodemus had to believe this too. But it might not have been easy for a man like that. After all, he was a leader of the Jewish ruling council. And Nicodemus had to die to all of that. And that would have been a big decision, because Nicodemus's titles, his status, and his pride was all stuck in his darkness. Do we sometimes resemble Nicodemus? It appears that we are all do resemble Nicodemus. Are we drawn by God, but also scared about what others might think? The slaves saw Nicodemus, they saw his night visit as proof that it was possible to come to Jesus, even though those in power forbid it. How many are there who have to live their lives in fear and hiding because of their faith? Even the oppressed who come to God in secret are drawn there by God. Nicodemus had an educated background and knowledge, but he lacked assurance. Nicodemus was very knowledgeable because of his position as a Pharisee. He was educated, and yet he did not find that having this knowledge made him feel secure. He was insecure as he was in a religious darkness. And Nicodemus was seeking light. And he realized that the one true light was Jesus Christ. In that what we are all searching for in our own lives, the assurance and confidence of light in the darkness. Unless we have the light that Jesus gives, we're always going to be living in the dark. However, using the clarity of light given to us by Jesus brings us out of the darkness of living without God in our hearts. But is being in darkness always a bad thing? During lockdown, one hobby which has become more popular than before is stargazing, whether that be classical astronomy or using a camera or telescope to take a photograph of the moon, stars, or galaxies. To facilitate this hobby, there's been an increasing awareness of dark skies. These are areas, often remote, where there is little light pollution. If you're in a dark sky area, you really, literally, are in a dark place. However, rather than being afraid of these dark places, astronomers and stargazers use them to heighten their senses and give more clarity to the light they see in the night sky. This is a lesson we could learn in our lives. When we feel the darkness of despair, we need not be afraid. We need to look for the light of Jesus. Use the contrast between the darkness of our lives and the light of his word to find the one true way. We can then be assured and confident. What is it that gives us the assurance and confidence that Nicodemus was looking for? The answer is faith. May we all use the darkness of our lives to go stronger in our own faith. Amen. I believe now Gemma's going to bring us some prayers.
So let's pray. You, O God, love us from the moment of our conception. You know us and you love us in the womb. You love us and you call us from before the moment of our first breath, and you love us when we first see the light of day. Your love guides us and encourages us to share our thoughts and concerns to you in prayer. Almighty God, we pray for those in government and local council. Please guide them, praying for honesty and actions without malice. God of mercy, we pray for those that suffer, those in hospital or poorly. We pray for your healing love to be with them. For people in dark situations, financial hardships, dealing with addictions or abuse, or those where we haven't noticed their hardship or loneliness. We pray for those that care for them to help with their needs. Holy Spirit of God, you never leave us comfortless, always walking beside us. We pray for those who have not noticed you are there with them or who have chosen to ignore you. For those who have lost their faith and for those who desperately need you. In the quiet, we name one or two such people before you and pray that they will raise their eyes to see you. Lord, we pray for togetherness. As the sun shines, let us feel the warmth of your love. Take time in company to focus on the now, enjoying friends, family, and fellowship. Thank you for the gift of the church and all those that work behind the scenes tirelessly. God of love, hold our church leaders in your arms. We pray for Simon and his family that this holiday is a time of reflection and restored energy. Loving and almighty God, please hear our prayers.
Amen. And now Gemma doesn't get a chance to sit down either. We've got our next hymn, which again, Liz and Emma and Gemma are going to lead us in. It's hymn number 663, Love Divine, All Loves Excelling, 663.
Thank you.
And we continue now with the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. And thanks to Emma, and Gemma, and Liz for leading us in singing this morning. Thanks also to Simon on the organ, and Will and Dennis, who hopefully are connecting various people at home with us here today. And probably thanks most of all to Bethany, I think, who was a nice distraction here at the front. I could see many an eye wandering towards Bethany. So as we leave, we please ask you that you maintain the one-way system and leave through the reception room. But before we go, a final prayer. Wonderful God, help us to keep adventuring with you. May we allow ourselves to be filled with visions of your awesomeness. And may we know your presence closer to us than our own breathing. Thank you for creating us, for being visible to us in Jesus, and for inspiring and empowering us with your interweaving spirit. And as we leave this worship, may we leave bathed in the light of your love. Amen.